for his guidance, glory to God. To give him his just due, hallelujah. To give him praise, to give him glory, hallelujah. How many know that it's a hard thing for a carnal man to give God glory? Hallelujah. And if you can open up your heart today, thank you for his glory, glory to God. For giving us that expression of worship, glory to God, and liturgical dance. If you can open up your heart and ask God for his guidance, and to know that you belong to him and he belongs to you, you can consider yourself blessed today and highly favored. Come on and say it with me, I'm blessed of the Lord.
You got to be, you got to
and say to yourself, I'm not interested in beating a dead horse. I need to know why I do what I do. What is the power behind my life? What is the power behind my very breath? What is the power behind me rising up out of bed in the morning and going about my daily doing? What is the power?
Amen.
And so it's time now for this great epidemic of people putting their hands into something and not even understanding what they're doing. See, it's a dangerous thing that, why do you think they have it where God has it, where children need parents, right?
Amen.
You don't leave a two-year-old unattended at any moment, at any time. Because it is possible that a two-year-old will they'll pick up a knife. If a knife is on, a two-year-old will pick it up, and what's going to happen? He's going to cut himself.
Wow.
So the significance of baptism is a powerful thing. And we're going to understand that the fact that a person participates in the things of God and you don't understand it, that same fire could come back and it could be of harm to you.
Say that. Amen.
That's right.
So
you got to understand the vital thing that keeps you alive. Where the scriptures say, in him you live and move and have your being. Amen. Thank God for my auntie here, all the way from Jamaica. Oh my God. I take you out to see her. Amen. God and my wife, to come visit us on today. Amen.
Amen.
Welcome those that are guests the first time in the house. Welcome, glory to God. Amen. Baptism is a ceremonial immersion in water. I am talking about the literal baptism, this natural thing that we do. It is a ceremony of dedication that symbolizes a spiritual experience with the Holy Ghost. So it is a dedication that symbolizes a spiritual experience. It is a purifying initiation of one's soul and heart. A spiritual cleansing that one come into agreement by accepting the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And so if you don't understand this, I'm going to be sure that everyone that is being baptized this morning is going to understand what they're doing and what is expected of them. I would never find myself baptizing anybody that don't go through this teaching first.
Amen.
Mark 16 and 15. Let's go to the book. We'll find out the initiation, the very commissioning of Jesus. You know, when he dwelled in the earth, he chose 12 men that he literally discipled. These 12 men somewhat became a prototype of the church today. They moved from a place of discipleship to a call of the apostleship. And the apostolic is another teaching, but this teaching is somewhat the power of the apostolic. It really is. Because without the baptism of the Holy Spirit, there is no apostolic anointing. There is no soul saved. There is no one being delivered. There is no casting out demons and all these things that we will see in the scripture without the power of God, such as these men are carried. So let's go to Matthew 16 and 15. This is where Jesus told them, and I want you to really, don't rush me today. Amen?
Amen?
We started very early, almost 45 minutes earlier. I got to get through this teaching, amen?
Amen.
And I want you to really get it. Everything is being recorded. If I'm going too fast in any area, Mark 16?
Mark
15, 16. And if it's not 15, it's 16. Mark 16, 15. It is being recorded, so you can always go back through it Amen. We did teach this message. We taught this the last time we baptized. Every time we baptize, we will be teaching this a message. Glory to God. I'm looking for one of y'all to be teaching it the next time. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Mark 16:15. And he told them, you got it? This is Jesus talking. Go into all the world and preach the good news. See yourself in this book. Preach the good news to somebody, or anybody, or everybody. Anyone who believes and is baptized will be saved. But anyone who refuses to believe will be condemned. 17th verse. These miraculous signs will accompany those who believe. They will cast out demons in my name. They will speak in new languages. 18 verse. They will be able to handle snakes with safety, and if they drink anything poison, it won't hurt them. They will be able to place their hands on the sick, and they will be healed. And so here we in scripture, we see the power that comes behind the power of God that Jesus Christ released upon the very church and released upon the very gifts of God. We have spiritual gifts and we have what is called ministry gifts. And so do you think that Jesus was giving his disciples such a powerful mandate or instruction without empowering them with his spirit? No, he said, go into all the world. He told them this after he had released them as a result of the power of the Holy Spirit. So this is the Apostle John. Glory to God. No, this is Jesus. But the Apostle John was first seen initiating baptism in the New Testament. Baptism is a result of the new covenant. Glory to God. I don't know of any baptism in the old covenant, but there's one that I'm going to somewhat talk about in regards to this message. So the new covenant is, we know, is as we are learning on Sunday morning, is a better way of living. Thank God for the better way of living.
Amen.
It is likely that they did not quite understand what baptism entailed, the magnitude of what this baptism experience was. And so we will come to know its significance, its importance in this teaching. Why do we baptize? So baptism, I'm going to go ahead and talk about in the Old Testament. I say they didn't baptize in the Old. But baptism was seen in the old. But it was seen in such a magnificent, vast way that everybody in this room will know this story. Remember the flood? When God told the man of God, Noah, to build an ark. Such huge boat was just so big and out of sync with what was going on at that time. And the thing about it, what's so strange is, back in Noah's days, it did not rain.
Wow.
And so the people did not understand what rain was. Noah didn't understand. But thank God for his obedience. So God told him to build this large boat, and I'm going to rain down my water from heaven. I'm going to cause even the deep to break up. And I'm going to flood out this earth, for the wickedness of man has come up to me and I'm done. So God told Noah, his wife, and his three sons and three daughter-in-law, 8 people, to go into the ark, that he is going to flood the earth. So the first baptism occurred with the earth itself. You're going to see that baptism is a form of a washing, glory to God. It's a form of eradicating, totally obliterating, totally excavating everything that's in the path of water. If you take something that's full of dirt, say it got mud on it, and you immerse it in a bucket of water, When you bring that ball, say a ball, it's full of dirt, and you take it out of that water, it's going to be what? Clean. All the dirt is going to what?
Wash away.
It's going to stay right there. It's not going to come up with that ball. Amen? But the water is going to be, going to release the dirt. Amen? So the first baptism was known upon the earth. You're going to see by the end of this teaching that not only God baptized the earth with water, like he baptized us with water and fire, but it's going to be baptized again with fire. Glory to God. Hallelujah. This is God's way. So baptism is a thing of the old and the new. The Bible says we were created what? Out of dirt itself. Dirt, you are dirt, you're going to return. So this dirt, this earth was baptized. This dirt will be baptized in water. But can this water thing I do save me?
Oh my God.
So the Apostle John's position was that of a forerunner of Christ. I'm going to tell you this. You, the church, the body of Christ, you are a forerunner of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yes. The Spirit of the Lord was upon John the Baptist. Yes. This man of God had such an insatiable desire and a passion for Christ. He knew his commission, his passion was for God and God alone. He saw nothing but the coming of the Savior that he quite didn't know anything about. So that same Spirit that rests upon John the Baptist is upon the church today. We are the forerunner of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Right.
Say with me, I'm baptized with the Holy Ghost.
I'm baptized with the Holy Ghost.
And fire. Therefore, I want men to be baptized with the Holy Ghost and fire.
Amen.
So that means I want to lead other men into this saving grace that I have for myself. But yet I got to have a healthy belief system in regards to my saving, the saving grace upon my life in order for it to work properly. I can't be influencing folk and leading them the wrong way. I got to lead them into this same baptism that John the Baptist knew, glory to God. And so, glory to God, we prepare that way in such a greater expression. Jesus said, the work I do, you shall do, and you shall do it in a big way. Glory to God. Go with me, Mark, the first chapter. Glory to God. Baptism in the Holy Ghost and fire. Being a son of God, being a child of God, being born of God's Spirit, all entails God's objective is to save you. Like he said, I'm not being slow concerning my promises that Jesus is coming back, but I'm being patient. This is what the word of God said. Not willing that none shall perish. I want everyone to come into repentance. But will everyone hear this gospel? So God don't save you. He don't baptize you in the Holy Spirit for naught. But he baptized you so you can go and work in his kingdom. Win the lost. At any cost. Mark 1:1. This is the good news about Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. It began just as the prophet Isaiah had written. See, John the Baptist had read those old patriarchs' letters and knew, they knew that something greater was coming. He said, look, the prophet Isaiah had written this. Look, I'm sending my messenger ahead of you. And he will prepare your way. Who was that messenger? John the Baptist. You are that messenger in this season and this hour. John the Baptist is long gone dead and gone. He's done his work. But you are that same messenger. His voice. He is a voice shouting in the wilderness. Prepare the way for the Lord's coming. Clear the road for him. Glory to God. This messenger was John the Baptist. He was in the wilderness and preached that people should be baptized to show that they had repented of their sins and turned to God to be forgiven. All Judea, including all the people of Jerusalem, went out to see and hear John. So John was out doing the mission field, preaching the gospel, evangelizing. They went to hear him. And when they confessed their sin, they heard the message he preached. He baptized them in the Jordan River. First they did what? Heard the message, right? Then they were what? Baptized in the Jordan River. And so God chooses to bring understanding to that which is natural to precede that which is what? Supernatural. First natural and then supernatural. We do this physical thing called baptizing in water, which is a natural thing, so that we can get an understanding of what the supernatural entails. And so again, the Apostle John ministry was an example to bring the understanding of the power of the Holy Spirit and the fire. So baptizing signifies a person's actual agreement. You don't just get baptized for the sake of it's right to get baptized, but you are, it's like signing a contract, glory to God, like a marital agreement. You agreed to be that woman's husband. What you mean you come home when you get ready? You agreed to make this man your husband. What you mean you don't feel like it? Lord, help me today. I mean, you agreed to this. What are you talking about? Hallelujah, right? Oh, Jesus. So he wanted them to understand the power of this. It's sort of like a prenuptial, an agreement before the marriage, okay? This is what we're going to agree on before we say our dues. This is what baptism is. Amen? You don't get the Holy Ghost by being baptized with water.
My God.
Yeah. No, you're going to really understand what we're saying today. Come on. So understanding the meaning of what you're doing strengthens your enablement, meaning your readiness, your willingness to just submit to whatever God wants. Submitting to the word and receiving it in a healthy way. It's like putting the cake in the oven, but yet you ain't turned the oven on. Wow. And then you go and look 45 minutes. I know my cake ready. And you got nerve to pull the oven down. I mean, it's cold and ice. And then you look at it and touch it and say, why this cake ain't nothing? It's not that crazy. This is what it means when a child of God, when they say they saved, and you don't have the Holy Ghost and the fire and the passion of God, the desire of God, the fruit of God's Spirit, the character of God living and breathing in you, and your willingness to shut down. But yet you expect to get the results of the power. Doesn't work. The oven is. Say with me, the oven is not on. Say with me, I need the fire. So you better understand a little bit more what the fire entails. Glory to God. So you need to understand there must be a fire. There must be a fervent heat in order to get the beauty out of holiness. You got to go through. You got, yea, do I walk through the valley of shadows of death? I will fear no evil. You got to go through your fire. You got to go through your trials and tests. You got to be tried. There got to be some passionate experience going on, good and bad. That cake can't come to this full potential until you get some fire. You can't come to your full potential until you understand what this fire entails. And so baptism is your personal yes to God. It shows you what the power of the Spirit does in the man. You get to experience them one-on-one. See, this can't be done by what they say. You can't be like the five foolish who had no oil in their lamp. Therefore, when Jesus came, they went to the wise and said, give us some of your oil. Our lamps are going out. And the wise said, oh, not so. We just got enough Holy Ghost and fire for us. You didn't understand that these last days entail the scarcity. God has warned us that I got to get this for myself. Glory to God. That man's heart must be willing and ready. when this is not understood, when your heart is not ready and it's not embraced properly, the man go down as a dry sinner in the water, and he comes up in the water as a wet sinner. Meaning, you dry now, you're a dry sinner. And you get baptized, you go down in the water, and you come back up a wet sinner. Meaning it did nothing for you. See, baptizing, going down in the water does nothing for you. It is only an allegory. It is only a metaphor. It is an example of what the fire of the Holy Ghost does in you. When you choose to go down in sin, and led it to die. The Bible says, except a grain of corn go in the ground, how you expect a harvest in the seed ain't went in the ground? It's got to die in order to spring forth. So this fleshly lifestyle, this will of man, this understanding that we have that's totally shut out of God must be eradicated. It must be dealt with according to our own will to say no. I already said no to flesh for you. Now it's your turn. He said, I've already died. I've already been whooped and bruised and battered. The weight of your sin was already on my shoulder. You choose to take it back. You take it back by living it out. So you got to tell sin, no longer you have no power over me. I'm going nuts. See, a wet sinner is still holding claims to what he had before he knew Christ. Meaning, a person that's still, you doing the same thing you used to do. You're holding claim to that. You have to be the one to rise up and say, you know what? Hell no. Tell hell no. Hell has enlarged itself every day, the Bible says. When you say no to hell, you say no to sin. Amen. When you say no to sin, you're saying no. Put it this way. Thank you, Lord. He said, when you say no to sin, you're saying no to hell.
That's right.
Hell is for sinners. Sinners are the ones who reject Christ. They reject the grace of God. Say with me, when I say no to sin,
I say no to hell.
The devil trying to make you think hell is a cuss word. No, it ain't. It's in the Bible.
Say so.
Tell hell no. And you got to be the first person to tell. It's a sin that lies in you. It's not other people's sin. That's wrong. Always looking over the other side and trying to judge other people. What about you? God said, what about the way you see it? I keep talking to you and you ain't hearing me. I keep trying to get them to hear you and you're not hearing me. It's like a child, a parent to a disobedient child. You instead of trying to get that child to obey you. And you ain't obeyed God yet. And God look down at you and say, you know. I'm glad you know how that feel.
Wow.
Serious, the Holy Ghost, I don't know about y'all, but he'll deal with me that way for many, many years. Oh, yeah. I said, okay, Lord, I see. So when you get that understanding, you can partner with the Holy Ghost. Then you and the Holy Ghost become one in union, in a marital reunion. And it is such a beautiful experience. So it is not the act of baptism that sanctifies the man, but rather it is the power behind embracing the act of the heart and soul. The heart and soul that's submitted to what? The truth. Anyone that is baptized, anyone the scripture say believes, is the heart and soul. With the heart, you believe with the mouth, confession is made to salvation. You don't confess something your soul ain't agreed with.
That's right.
So baptism is the embracing the art, the act, with the entire heart and soul, which in fact is living the spirit life that you are. Say with me, I am spirit.
I am spirit.
That's the real me.
That's the real me.
You are not a soul.
Right.
And you're not a body.
Right.
You are a spirit.
Yes.
And you have a soul.
Yes.
Meaning I have a hand.
Yes.
That's not who I am.
Yes.
This hand is not who I am. This body is not who I am. They
yes.
burn it up. I'm still alive.
Right.
Spirit. I just have a body.
Amen.
You just have a soul. Glory to God.
Right.
The soul and the spirit goes back to God.
Yeah.
Or it goes back to whoever you give it to. If you gave it to the devil, if you gave it to hell, remember if you don't say no to sin, then you're saying yes to hell.
Right.
If you gave it to hell, then that's where the body goes.
Oh,
so you don't want to go there. God has not called you to go there.
Amen.
So you surrender all to him by knowing, having a healthy understanding. Go with me to Matthew 3:11. And this, there's going to be many short teachings that I'm going to take you through. This particular one shows the difference, the significance of baptism. I talked about it just a little bit in that example. The significance of baptism is a separating and an impartation. The earth was separated from sin with the flood of water that wiped out everything, wasn't it? For real. For real, though. Check this out. God wiped out sin in the earth because he said man's wickedness has come before me and stank before me. He wiped out sin with the flood of water that everything, sin and everything, was totally eradicated. Say, that's the power of God.
That's the power of God.
I can be healed.
I can be
delivered.
I can be delivered.
And I am called to be whole.
And I am called to be
whole. Glory to God.
Glory to God.
You got to say this to yourself. I am called to be healthy. I am called to be whole. I am called to be enabled to hear my daddy God say, well done. You know, people look for other people to affirm them.
Say that.
They look for other people to, oh, you're doing a good job. Honey, if I were you,
that's right.
I'd get that misconception right.
Yes, amen.
This is a touching message for me. It's so close to my heart. You know why? Because it is so vital that even I want our teenagers to understand this. And I know they have heard it before. But we need a refresher. Matthew 3:11. John said, I baptize with water those who repent of their sins and turn to God. But someone is coming soon. This is what John said. This is what we should be talking about. This is what we should be preaching today. Someone is coming.
Yes.
You know the apostles told the men that rested daily at the synagogue. And he sat there begging. The apostles told him, silver and gold we don't have. But such as we have, we give it. Get up. This is our duty. To tell people, get up.
Amen. Amen.
Get up.
Amen.
Get up.
Jesus.
It is time for us to live this gospel with everything we got.
Lord,
say with me, I want the passion of John the Baptist.
I want the passion of John the Baptist.
He said, someone is coming greater than I am. So much greater. I'm not even worthy to be his slave and carry his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. He is ready to separate the chaff from the wheat with his renowned fork.
Yes.
Then he will clean up the threshing area, gathering the wheat into his barns.
Hallelujah.
Burning the chaff with never-ending fire. I had some pictures that I didn't quite get a chance to put up on the screen to show you what a threshing floor looks like. But I'm going to try to appeal to your imagination. A threshing floor is a place of separation. We don't understand what a threshing floor is today. There are people that still works in that way of farming, such as separating the wheat from the chaff, separating the grain from the huff from the bad stuff. The Winnowing fork is such a big fork, and what they would do is stick it in that wheat, that hay, or whatever material they're working with, and they would throw it up so the bad part would separate from the good. I don't know how they do that. Maybe they did it. Maybe they had wind blowing in the midst. I don't know. I don't understand at all. But the threshing floor is a place of separation. Spiritually, we talk about a threshing floor being a place to lay before God, a place of separating, a place of giving up something for God's everything, giving up nothing. It's a place of separation. It's a place of repentance. A place of coming clean with God. This is what water baptism symbolizes. Remember I said the bowl? It was dirty. But when you take it down in that bucket and bring it up, the dirt is separated. When you go down in that water, I can remember my first time being baptized. And I was young, I think I was a teenager, but I had such a passion for God. I just cried. I didn't even understand why I was crying. I just cried. I've been crying for years, you know. I tried to stop, but there's such a love for God. And I can feel the passion of what was going on, and I know it was a spiritual experience that I didn't understand the whole part of it. But it was enough to keep me somewhat. All I needed after that was some good teaching.
That's right.
And I need to be around sound spiritual people to help counsel me and take me where I needed to go.
That's right. Yes.
Every healthy belief system is a result of a healthy teaching.
Yes, Lord.
And being around wholesome spiritual things. You can cause yourself to be in the wrong place, that cause yourself to really be caught up. The Bible says there's a way that seems right unto a man, but at the end, there is destruction. We're living in an age where it seemed right to get pregnant and have children at the age of 18. Our children don't understand what it means to abstain from sexual activity. We're living in a world where our children think, oh, I'm a girl, and since no boy don't like me, I'll just like another girl. So there is a scarcity of truth to separate air from what is truth. And this is what the power of the Spirit do in you, in every individual. If each one reach one, the body of Christ can come up. If you are partaking in baptism today, by your initial yes to God, your first yes, or you're rededicating yourself to God, you got to understand what holiness means to the Lord. There's a name written upon those that belong to God in the end of days, and that name was holy to the Lord. I believe that name is somewhat stamped on us today spiritually. Just like Cain had a mark put on him that if anyone touch him, God will repay them harm. I believe his mark, the mark of the Holy Ghost, stamp his approval that heralds out that you are holy to the Lord. Meaning that you're sanctified, you are separated This is what separation does. It separates you. It puts you on another level. It don't put you in a place where you look at people like you're better than them. But it puts you in the place that you have that same compassion that Jesus had. The Bible talks about when Jesus looked upon the crowd, he saw their disparity. He saw them as a people without shepherd. And he had compassion upon them. And then he said, pray the Lord of the harvest that he sent for laborers to work this harvest, that these people can be saved. Glory to God. This is what this separation brings. Say with me, the separation brings the power of the Holy Spirit. And it brings the mind of Christ, which I need. The Bible says, be ye changed, be renewed in your mind. Be changed by the renewing of your mind. What do you renew it with? The Word of God. And so John the Baptist, baptism was symbolic, as we said. And it represents the Spirit of God, separation, purification, sanctification, just as it happened in the earth. Glory to God.
Amen.
So first, the man's heart and mind has to repent. Now, repentance, many people have gotten this word really twisted up. And the defining of this word is really not understood by many. Repentance has nothing to do with the words you say. A repentant heart is a changed heart. This is what repentance means. I'm going east. Now I'm going west. I totally made a 360. I repented. I'm not going that way. It means first you were going the wrong way. And now you choose to go what? The right way. You know why? Your words will not really solidify the act. Because you know what? What'd you say, Auntie?
New creature.
That's it. That's it. New creature. All things are past. That's it. And you walk that out.
Yeah.
You don't talk.
That's right.
See, the talk comes as a result of the walk.
Yeah.
The walk comes first and then the talk.
Yeah.
See, when the horse goes before the cart can't move.
Yeah.
See, talk is cheap. Proverbs talk about the man talking, saying things with his heart, and he really don't mean it. Proverbs really show us up right there. But it is the act of a man's heart in the activity of his very lifestyle. It's what heralds out loud that I am married to Christ. And that I'm filled with his Spirit. That I am a new creature. Glory to God. When there is a change of heart, there's a change of thought. There's a change of motive. There's a change of perspective. Meaning your outlook. The way you see things. You no longer see things as many people see God as trying to get away with something. God is trying to get up on all people. God always wants me to do something, but he just don't understand. When you really connect and become one and married with the Holy Ghost, you'll speak like he do. And the only way you can do that by connecting with his word. See, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit alone killeth. The letter alone killeth. But the Spirit gives life. That's what I mean to say. You can't have the word without the Spirit. It's like trying to have that cake in the oven without the fire. Without the 400 degrees that the oven need to be on. It ain't gonna do. The Spirit of God gives life. It gives passion. It gives understanding. It brings forth the fruit of God's Spirit. So it is a moment, this separation, of embracing with your whole heart, mind, and soul. A husband and wife get married. It's honeymoon time. And she's so caught up. Oh, I'm so happy. Me and my husband, we just so happy. I just love me some him. He just love me some me. And we just all in love together. And we just caught up and we just having a good time. See, God would give us that which is natural to get us to understand what it is spiritually. See, that's the way it goes spiritually. When you are in Christ, Jesus said, if my word is in you, it abide in you, and I abide in you, and my word abide in you, and you abide in me, you can say what you want, and I'll give it to you. You know why he said that? Because I trust my word. He trusts that his word is going to always ask what he wants. Why? Because now you become one with God. And you're excited about that. People don't see you saying you just got saved, just got baptized. People see you like this. What rag come off a honeymoon looking like this? You look, sis, I just came from your wedding a week ago. You all right? No, that was the marriage from hell when it was the honeymoon from hell. We got to stop getting this twisted. Making our lifestyle with God seem like this connection with God wasn't working for me. Can't you see the word today that I got wasn't working for me? Don't you see it? It's Monday morning. You see it on my face? Don't you see it? No, you go to work and there's spring in your step. You got the Holy Ghost and you got the biggest smile on your face. There's an aura about you. There's an oil about you. There's a joy that's far beyond your own. You don't even know why you're so happy. I'm the perfect one to talk about this. I know what all hell breaking loose. I know what bad news is. Having the joy of Lord, just totally caused you to be counterfeited so you think you're crazy. I know what that means. I got some witnesses. I know what that means. Nobody has any idea, but it is this joy of the Lord. This marital union with the Spirit. This I do, I say it to him, is what I need. Glory to God. It's amazing to me how men can submit to everything and everybody. But you have a problem submitting to the Holy Ghost. Say with me, I need to get this. Well, you're driving down the road and an officer right there on the corner. What you do? Let up off that gas? And you're like, oh, wow. Oh, I almost got caught.
Wow. Yes, good teaching.
But yet when you get all in the darkness by yourself, John said, prove to me. And we're going to get to that scripture. I don't want to get ahead of myself. That you accepted that you are here to get what you really want from God. Say with me, I got to be proven and I got to be tested. Say with me, I'm going to pass my test. Oh, yes, you are. Glory to God. See, when you got so much information, it's impossible. God has basically given you a cheat sheet in the Word of God, and it is the Word of truth. Hallelujah. Glory to God. When you submit to God, you become a byproduct of what the Holy Spirit entails. When you submit to sin, you become a byproduct of what the wages of sin entails. There's a consequence. You got to prove that you are separated from sin. I need to prove this. I need to see this.
Yes, God.
You can't change yourself.
No.
God, if every man be honest with himself, say with me,
the truth is,
I can't change myself.
Because
I try. And self don't work.
Self-help.
Self-counsel. bring self-preservation. So I can't look in the manual of what I see and single through what is appeasing to me. You know how men sit and they contemplate? You got to learn to look when self is doing this thing. You got to say, oh, hell no. I'm not doing that. Holy to the Lord is who I am.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
We fail every time when we try.
Yes, we do.
John told those that he baptized, something greater is coming. Meaning there is more to come that will not only give you a quick fix. See, drugs give you a quick fix. Alcohol give you a quick fix. Weed is only a quick fix. Lust is only a quick fix. Promiscuity is only a quick fix. A lie is a quick fix. The moment you let a lie fester up in your soul, it's the day you die. But John says, someone greater is coming. He will baptize you with Holy Ghost and fire. Meaning he's going to give you something that's going to last throughout eternity. See, there's a difference between authentic stuff and fake stuff. Jesus! Somebody, fake stuff don't last. Fake gooches don't last. Fake leather don't last. Not even fake pleather don't last. But there is something about durability. You got to want the good stuff. Glory to God. Power of the Holy Spirit. I'm stretching you a little bit this morning because I want you guys to get this whole message. I usually teach this in two or three lessons, but I cut it down to one. We're going to get this. The fire brings separation, we said. The baptism of the Holy Spirit came upon the church already. It was the day of Pentecost. When Jesus left, he gave them instructions. He said, go in the upper room and wait there. I got something for you. When you trust people that you're connected with and they tell you they got something for you and you know it's good.
Right, that's right.
Say with me, who would show up? You think I let pride keep me from showing up? Some people are so proud. I don't need nothing. You don't need nothing. This separation, this day of Pentecost, was a separation. It was a separation of the chaff, as the Bible used, as symbolic of a real threshing floor. And we say a chaff is the husk, which is the shell, like peanuts. You don't eat the shell of a peanut. Some people do, but they're crazy as hell. But seriously, the Bible called people food. Look at Proverbs. But it is crazy to eat the shell. You know why? Because it's going to rip up your intestines. Not only rip up your intestines. You eat peanut shells, it will rip away. If literal peanuts will, if you don't chew them all the way up, husk will rip up your intestines. And you'll find yourself bleeding.
Yes,
in that lonely place. You know what I'm talking about. For real.
That's real.
So husk is the junk. This separating it separates the, it moves the worthless matter. The stuff that don't make sense. You know, like when they slay a hog back in the old days when they say the black folk discovered chitlin. When the our Caucasian brother would separate the bad part, we would take the bad part and make it food.
Yeah.
And it will totally kill you.
Yes.
You keep eating that junk.
Come on.
Say with me, yuck. That's junk.
That's nasty.
That's nasty. Paul chilling is nasty. It really is. Well, Elvis says you cook them right. It's still nasty. It's nasty. When they put all that vinegar in it, it do kind of taste. It do, but it is nasty. It is nasty. Say with me, I ain't eating no junk. Naturally, you don't eat the junk spiritually. There must be a separating. See, your eye gate, your ear gate, your mind gate, these are portals. These are open doors to the junk. So you got to see your ears as holding unto the Lord. I'm not listening to that music no more. And I'm not listening to these shows no more. Come on, Jerry Springer. Turn that garbage off. Some more than bad. What that woman name? That said, hello. Wendy. Hello, how you doing? That's supposed to have all the news. Turn that junk off. Anytime you sit and listen to a gossip column, come on, break it down, y'all. Because I want y'all to get this word. Anytime you sit and you listen to that garbage, you open yourself up and you cause the separating that was supposed to take place to be stopped. You call it to be. It's just like somebody, you letting somebody come in on your intimate relationship between you and your husband. You allow that to be separated. You allow that fellowship, that intimacy between you two to be interrupted. So now you got to come back and work hard and bring yourself back again. Glory to God. Say with me, there must be separation. Glory to God. So there must be a separation and a baptism. Again, this is your yes to the Spirit of God, as we say. To choose to do His will as He see fit. Not as you see fit. As He choose to do it, what? In you, and then what? Through you. Meaning I'm on this potter's wheel. And I can't just get myself off. How you get on a potter's wheel and you say, I'm getting down from him? Picture this, a potter's wheel. The potter with his mud, and he got his pot on the wheel. Can that pot get off the wheel? So a real work of God. That's in the hand of God. If you're in the hand of God, you can't just get out of God's hand. You can't just get off the potter's wheel. Even though when you think you've missed it. I hear God. It's not that you missed it. God say, it's that I'm showing you how desperate you are for me. I'm showing you in your moment of you think you're missing it, but I'm showing you in this moment that apart from me, you can't do anything. Did you know God left the 99 to just go after the one? He said, I'm married to the backslider. You are mine and you belong to me. Yes. I bought you with my own blood. Yes. Jesus said, though that the Father gave me, I'm not giving you up. So you got to understand, he wants you to get this, that I'm separated.
Amen.
Separated for his special use. And the chaff is burned, what? With never-ending fire, which signifies a perpetual cleansing. It is a perpetual separation that goes on in our lives. And as many as a time you choose to partake and commemorate in the memory of that, Jesus, we do that, what? In the Lord's Supper. As many, as oft you like to show forth my death until I come, we have a Lord's Supper. We take the bread and the wine. It's a powerful thing to remember. I'm commemorating this yes. I'm commemorating this yes to the point where, Lord, I'm letting you know that I am in this with my all. Doesn't matter that things are not working how I see it should work. But I got to understand that I'm being tried and I'm being tested. And that I am willing to go through my test.
Yes.
And so the earth will have a second baptism, which is fire. This purification will take place before the new Jerusalem will come down. New heaven and new earth, as we talked about in the book of Revelation. Go with me with 2 Peter 3:9. Some of these I might have to just give you the scripture. 2 Peter 3:9. When you play with the baptism of the Holy Spirit and what baptism signifies, it's like you're being just like these people in this passage. No, this is not the passage. But I'm going to read this one. All right. The Lord isn't being slow. It's above that. This passage is up higher, probably the 6th through the 8th verse, but I'm starting at the 9th. The Lord isn't being slow about his promise as some people think. Yes, that's them. No, he's being patient for your sake. He does not want anyone to be destroyed, but wants everyone to repent. Say with me, I understand what repentance means. It's a change of heart. A change of direction, change of lifestyle, a total eradicating of the old, embracing the new. 10th verse. But the day of the Lord will come as unexpectedly as a thief. The heavens will pass away with a terrible noise, and the very element themselves will disappear in fire. See that baptism? And the earth and everything on it will be found to deserve judgment. Since everything around us is going to be destroyed like this, what holy and godly lives you should live. Looking forward to the day of God and hurrying it along. On that day, he will set the heavens on fire and the elements will melt away in flames. But we are looking forward to the new heaven, the new earth he has promised, a world full with God's righteousness. Glory to God. So we see that the earth itself will experience a baptism of God's righteous indignation by way of a fire that will consume everything on the earth. This is the redeeming of the earth, bringing it back to its original state. An extreme makeover, somewhat. If you are not baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire, you cannot be saved. Today is the day to give your whole self to God. Today is the day to rededicate yourself to God with a sincere heart. That God, I give you everything. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I live for you alone. Every breath I take, every moment I'm awake, have your way in me.
Yes.
Just as a spouse give themselves to each other, you got to know that you first need to give yourself to God and to God alone. The Apostle John, I must go through this one, discerned the hearts of men, and he knew that they were not ready. I want to speak about this because you don't have to continue to be rebellious and do your own thing. And you don't also have to be hard towards those that are trying to help you get what you need.
Say that.
Why? Because God gives leadership the ability to discern something. Not only do we have to discern it, we see it literally.
Amen.
And then you still lie, say, don't judge me, don't judge you.
That's
what
it.
You mean don't judge you? Let's get to the book.
Say that.
Taking your salvation lightly as if it means nothing breaks God's heart. Go to Matthew 3:7. Because we saw in scripture said that he wished that none should perish, that all come to repentance. All will open their hearts to receiving what repentance entails. Matthew 3 and 7. We're going to look at the Apostle John with those who were basically onlookers. They wanted what this salvation entailed, what John was preaching about. They heard about him. John became somewhat newsworthy because he was sort of like weird. So yes. Some of the things and the way he dressed and the food he ate, he was not like a normal man. So I'm sure John was always on the news and people was, you see this man, he's over here baptizing people in this river. Go over there and see. So the Pharisees, let's go check this out. Let's go check out what is going on. They have no idea. So the Spirit knows if our heart is ready or if you haven't made up your mind. Say with me, I need to make up my mind.
I need to make up my mind.
Every day you wake up, you're making up your mind to be separated. Seriously. The Bible says the race is not given to the strong or the fast, but it is given to those who will hold out and endure to the end. Meaning, every day I wake up, I got to be enabled to say in myself, I choose to receive Christ. I choose to maintain status quo, to resume my relationship. Because at any moment, you can stop if you want to.
Yes, yes.
Just stop. You know how you quit people? I quit her. I quit him. I ain't with him no more. Oh, we divorced. We ain't married no more. Oh, we're not best friends anymore.
Yes, ma'am. Choice.
Oh, yeah, people choose to just discard God. I don't go to church no more. What you talking about? Peter's like, I don't know the man. Don't make me cuss. And you know he cuss, right? He was a Christian. They said, oh, he looked like Jesus. Peter's like, Peter knew that Christ was getting ready to go through suffering. See, in the end time, people know you're going to have to get your head decapitated to be saved. You need to be on Monday nights to hear about that. Or go back to our archive on our YouTube channel. It ain't got to be decapitated. It's going to come to a day in this season, in this world, in this era where people going to say, Jesus, I got no Bible. Seriously.
Yes, ma'am.
Because if they find you just like they do over in China and some of these other countries, these people are already going through that now. They have to hide to worship. They have to hide to pray. They have to hide to have church. Police can't come stop us now. He'll be out of order.
Okay. Thank God.
But there are coming a time when God snatch us. They'll pray for our government. When God snatch his spirit, he snatch the church out of him. And y'all people that left behind that's playing with it, y'all not me. Say with me, y'all not me.
Y'all not me.
See that person. Hey, man, I don't mean to drop you up, but I'm going to see if you're going to open your mouth. See, hey, the five wise say, and we got all. It was the five foolish. And God's wish is that everybody, it's my heart that everybody.
That's right.
So vital. So vital. But this is what John said to these people. I'm going to stretch y'all a little bit more.
That's all right.
Matthew 3:7. Listen to this. Are you there in scripture?
Yeah.
John said, this was during John day. But when he saw many, he is talking about John, many Pharisees and Sadducees coming to watch him baptize, he denounced them. He said, you brood of snakes. He exclaimed, who warned you to flee God's coming wrath? Prove by the way you live that you have repented of your sin and turned to God. Wow, that sounds so mean. First the man called the people named any touch. That ain't Christian. Oh, really? What Bible are you reading? Because God knows the hearts of men. Heart of God. Then the ninth verse say, he say, then he deserved them again for the third time. Then he say, don't just say to each other, we're safe for we are descendants of Abraham. That means nothing. The man called him a name. Then he judged them. Then he told them what they was thinking. Don't be talking about we Abraham children. Don't you know our forefathers? We are Israel. We are of the tribe of Benjamin. He said that means
nothing.
For I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones. Even now the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the root of the trees. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be what? Chopped down and thrown in the fire. And so we see the Holy Ghost of God in his vessel, who knew the intentions of the people. That's why when we preach as ministers of the gospels, as pastors and leaders, evangelists and pastors and prophets and encouragers, we got to have the passion in the heart of God.
Yes.
You can't be stroking people.
Come on.
We have to tell them the truth so they can be what? Healed. And this is not judging.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Say that.
You got to call the book what it is. If it's lying, you're lying.
That's right. Snake is a snake.
A snake. It's a snake.
Yes, ma'am.
Stroke a snake and see where you might not go away. That was me, though. Seriously, though. Come close to anything that's not like God and see how you stay alive.
That's right.
You got to discern the time.
That's
right. So, baptism is not something to do and say that you know God, but yet your intentions is what God is looking at.
Right.
What is in your heart?
Right.
You got to look and say, what is in my heart? It must be God.
Amen.
And you got to be willing to give it up.
Yes.
What John was doing was newsworthy. As I said earlier, people heard. See, people are hearing about this salvation. They hear about the blessings of God. They hear about the promises of God. It all sounds good. Many of them in Christianity because they want the stuff, but they don't want nothing to do with God. I'm talking about preachers also. We just in this for what we get. God called them hirelings. They're in it for what they can get. If you can't stroke my palm, then I don't want nothing to do with you.
That's real.
But John, he discerned their hearts. They were clueless to understanding the significance of what baptism means, even in the Holy Ghost and fire, what the natural water baptism means, just like some of you are. They were clueless. So when men are clueless, it is our duty to make sure they understand.
Right.
We got to stop screaming and hollering at people.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Say that.
Many are in the church and they are literal onlookers.
Yep.
You become an onlooker. An onlooker is what is one that has a form of godliness. Meaning they look like they know God. They look the part, but inward they don't know him. See, to know him is to know his fruit, his character, to know his love, his joy, his peace, his long-suffering, his kindness, his gentleness, to know what holiness is, to know what makes him happy, what pleases him. John said, okay. First, the man of God, he called him Bruce's name. He said, meaning you are cunning, you're trying to fool me. He said, I know you just come to see what I'm doing because you just heard about it. But that's all right. He gave him another chance. He said, prove to me that you come to get what I got.
Amen.
Say with me, I got to
prove
to God. No, not to God. Say with me,
no, not to God.
Y'all thought y'all were trapping y'all up? To myself. Because God already knows. But you don't know. You don't know your intentions until you walk them out.
That's
right,
man. That's
seriously. Because
right.
Our emotions get us tied up.
Right.
We get emotional. Oh, yes, baby. You are my everything.
No.
But yet, why are you doing otherwise? If I'm your everything. This is what God said. If you love me, why are you doing? I mean, I see you serving yourself. He said, if you love me, you'll keep my commandment, you'll serve me, you'll do what I say. But I see you doing what?
Yes.
something else say. God said, you say you love me. Prove to me that you love me.
That's right.
Prove.
Amen.
Prove it to yourself. Because God say, I already know you. Amen. But he wants you to get it.
Thank you, Lord.
This was John's way of rebuking them or calling them names, bruised snakes. One thing about a person that really wanted, say it with me, one thing about a person that really wanted,
one thing about a person that really wanted,
they ain't easily offended.
They ain't easily offended.
God will let the woman of God or the man of God offend you. See how bad you want to serve Jesus. God said, I'm gonna see how bad you want to work in my thing. Let me see if you can handle it. Can you handle this test? Or you gonna whip up and say, well, see, God, you know, they shouldn't have looked at me that way.
Wow.
You didn't know you got to prove that you in this thing and that you serve God and not the minister? God will let them make you mad, take you off. Just for you to prove it.
Yes, God.
To yourself, not God.
Yes,
God say, I already know.
Yes,
but I'm showing you the real you. Say with me, that's the real me.
That's the real me.
Real me say, I ain't got time for that. It's the truth. The real man. Now y'all think I can talk about this thing? Been there, done that. But I stood my test. And I passed them. And I choose to continue to pass them. Say with me, a fish won't get me. Call me what you want. I know who I am. And I know who I serve. I prove to you who I really am. And that's all you got to do. You know, I might have missed it. I might have been a brood of snakes. I might have been a viper. But I'm going to prove to you that I want this thing. Amen. This is what the people were being challenged with. Amen?
Amen.
Then the scripture say,
my Lord.
Amen.
He say, show me what you got. Meaning turn from your wicked self.
That's right.
Don't try to use your culture. And tell me about our fathers Abraham, because I already know.
Right.
Don't try to tell me your mama was a preacher, your daddy was a preacher. I want to hear about you had four granddaddies that was preachers. Basically.
Amen.
Say with me, this personal.
Personal. That's the
good.
Good Lord. Oh, my.
Abraham, see? Is a righteous one. And God is in control of that. See, they thought they could trick the man of God. We Abraham seed. No, you Abraham seed, for real. There's a spiritual seed.
Yeah.
It's a spiritual birthday that includes Jews and Gentiles alike. Woman, men, male, or female.
Amen.
They didn't understand that.
Amen.
Then John say, now you are under God's judgment. And that is which is holy is getting ready to be wood. Take this axe. He say the axe is laid at the root of the tree. Meaning you play with God. You play with Christianity. You know how people fake it. They ain't really saved. They come into church and do whatever. And then they go out 4 days, 7, 6 days a week. They live otherwise. What the word is saying? The judgment of God.
Yes, right.
Every man is styled as a tree.
Come right. On.
The Bible talks about us being trees planted by the rivers of water.
Yes,
and our roots go on deep. Yes. And our leaves not with them. So you know he's talking about men, right?
Amen.
He said the axe. Meaning the very word. The very thing you touch. The judgment of God is laid bare. At the foot of your life, and you getting ready to be consumed. He said, first the axe is what? The axe hacked the tree, and then it's what? The tree is what?
Cut down,
thrown in the fire. And when it's thrown in the fire, it's what? In other words, you have better know what you are doing, or you will be totally consumed.
I don't know why I'm drooling so much this morning.
Yes, that's fine.
My sinuses have
picked up.
I know the devil didn't want this word to go forward. We are almost there.
So the judgment is laid. I got a whole box of tissue. The judgment of God is laid at the root of a tree and ready to chop down everything that does not bring forth godly fruit.
Amen.
When you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, you bring forth the fruit of his righteousness.
Right.
Proverbs 11:30, the tree of life, the fruit of righteousness is the tree of life. He that wins souls is wise. So you are that tree of life, and you must bring forth the fruit of God. So baptism is not something to get a little certificate and say I've been baptized. And neither is it one where people take their baby and sprinkle a little water on their head. None of that means anything. But it is a significance of that child of God understanding that my entire life, now I have went down. I'm symbolizing that. I'm going down in this water. And that when I'm coming up and I'm free in Christ.
Amen.
And I just did this little ceremony, you see, just to show forth my agreement with God. He said, anyone that believes and is baptized shall be saved. But the baptized that the Bible is talking about is not water baptism. Water baptism is just an act.
Yes, ma'am.
Glory to God. It is not a moment to appease your guilt, because many people are guilty of their sins. Mm-hmm. Then they get baptized and think that's going to help them be not guilty.
Mm-hmm.
And then they go back to their sinful ways. That is not what it's all about.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Many people get baptized so they can feel better. This is just an example, an illustration of what takes place as we have explained. It is a beautiful example, which becomes a beautiful experience. Amen. This is what the baptism of the Holy Spirit brings. Matthew 3:13. Then Jesus went from Galilee to the Jordan River to be baptized by John. But John tried to talk him out of it. I'm the one who needs to be baptized by you. He said, so why are you coming to me? But Jesus said, it should be done. For me, we must carry out all that God requires. So John agreed to baptize him. After his baptism, as Jesus came up out of the water, the Bible says the heavens were opened. And he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and settling on Jesus. And a voice from heaven, God said, this is my dearly beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased, and who brings me great joy, some translation said. And so it was after John baptized Jesus that the heaven was open, after, not before, and the Spirit of God descended. So baptism was a way, this symbolic way that we do today, was a literal way that God chose to allow his Spirit to literally come down. And so people think that until I go down in the water, the Spirit ain't gonna come down. That's not true. The Spirit has already come down. Because the head, the Son of the living God, he has already received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And then when he was in the earth, he said, I got to go. Don't touch me. I must ascend to my Father. And when I go up to my Father, I'm going to send the Holy Spirit. So he was the receiver of the Holy Ghost. And also he was the one who released the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost. That beautiful experience has already come. And it has already happened. You are already filled with God's Spirit. You are already anointed, approved by God. Stamp hallelujah as glory to God. of the Lord. You don't have to wait to go down in the water to be holy. You are holy now. You just need to know that I gotta walk this out, that I can't allow no enemies, no devil, no spirit of hell, no self to come between my marital relationship, between me and the spirit of my God. Say with me, he belongs to me, and I belongs to him. And I'm glad about it. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Ghost. Thank you for your Holy Ghost desire. Thank you for the oil of the anointing. Thank you that I'm healed. Thank you that I'm whole. Thank you that I'm free. Thank you that I'm one with your spirit. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Hallelujah. For all those that are getting baptized this morning, I want you to just come down to the front. Glory to God. We're going to pray a prayer over you, glory to God. And after this prayer, we're going to, we'll have the ushers come to do the offering. And we will not do any announcements today. Right after the offering, the ministers will be preparing. I hope they're prepared and ready. Have the baptism robes ready. And we'll just take our... jump in our cars and go to the beach. Amen?
Amen.
I hope you brought a change of clothes, right? Everybody brought a change. If you straight, the men are straight. They don't take much for them. It don't take much for them. Glory to God. Father, we just thank you. Just anoint each one of you for me. Glory to God. Some of you are coming as a renewal, a refreshing. Glory to God, you can be baptized as many times as you want. You understand this experience is just like a, you know, when a husband and wife go through their anniversary and they do something different. This is a renewal, glory to God, or it may be an initiation. It may be a first-time experience for some of you. But I really, God's will is that you really understand this and that you really feel that closeness and that union with God, that you are really one with him. I am one, and you are one with him now, even before we get to the water, glory to God. You just need to take a authority over everything that belongs to you and be ready to tell every devil from hell, no, that I understand that I've already gone down. Jesus went down in the grave, so therefore my sin is in the grave. And it ain't coming back up. Why? Because I ain't going to help it up. I'm not going to give it any power. Father, we just thank you, Lord God, for your people, these candidates, oh God, that decided, Lord God, to take on this experience as your word says, oh God. Father, we thank you for your oil of the anointing, oh God, that rests upon each one, Lord God, as your daughter lay hands on them, Father. We pray that they will understand that this experience, glory to God, is not what it takes to be filled with your spirit, but this is just a symbol of it's just a yes, it's just another agreement. I understand that I am filled with God's spirit for the mere asking, glory to God. Oh, Father, I ask that there will be such a renewal like never before, and this experience will cause a refreshment. Oh, so much so that intimacy will be counterposed to another level, oh God, that your experience in them, Lord God, will cause river the water, Lord God, to be stirred in their bellies, oh God. Oh, Father, open them, Lord God. Oh, Father, give them a heart of repentance, Lord God. Being able to say, whatever held me back, I repent of it now. I turn away from it now. I turn away from every enemy, every spirit of hell, glory to God. Every spirit that seeks to devour me. Every wrong focus and distraction. I choose to give it up, glory to God. Hallelujah. Some of you just need to repent right now. Just tell the Lord, Lord, I'm turning in my soul. I'm turning in the activities of my life. Glory to God. I'm turning. I ask that you forgive me. Lord, forgive me. Now, you can ask the Lord to forgive you, but the believing of that forgiveness and the receiving of that forgiveness will walk out in your lifestyle. Your repentant heart, glory to God, will be a result, glory to God. You walking this out will be a result of you receiving the forgiveness. If you receive God's forgiveness, you will live like it. Glory to God. And so, Father, we thank you, Lord, that each one is ready for this experience. Glory to God. And we thank you such a joy. We thank you such a river of living water. Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to God. Come on and praise him. Hallelujah. Christopher, are you ready? Are you ready for this? Are you ready for this today? You ready, really? You ready? Glory to God. Hallelujah. The proving of your readiness is going to show out, glory to God, in your lifestyle. We thank you, Lord God, that your people are ready to say yes to you again, God, through this experience. Hallelujah, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I do hear God saying, expect another level of his spirit. Another challenge. A challenge beyond what you could normally being able to go through. Expect a challenge beyond what, you know how you get some challenge and you can master that? But God say when you desire to go up higher in him, yes, there's going to be other challenges that's going to come to prove and test your willingness to go up. Because spiritually you go up in God. You don't stay the same, you go up higher. There's a refreshing. And to the point you'll begin to see and feel in your life like you're floating. Like you're merely just floating, like, wow, I am really loving this experience. There's a love for God in this experience like never before. And I know that each of you are going to experience that. I prophesy that over you. That you will experience another level of God, a level that you've never been before. There will be such a joy and a refreshing of God's spirit upon you that the devil in hell can't have you. Alcohol can't have you. Lust can't have you. Demons can't have you. Unforgiveness can't have you. No spirit of hell, no demonic influence from the flesh, from the world, glory to God. All of it is under your feet, glory to God. So you got to just stand up and declare that lust can't have me. Promiscuity can't have me. Nothing can have me, glory to God. Why? Because I'm stamped with the stamp of God's approval. Holiness unto the Lord. I speak that over you. Holiness to the Lord. You will walk it out in this life, glory to God. I declare that over you, that you will walk it out. Amen. Any part of the teaching that you, anybody that's up here in the front, any part of this teaching that you did not understand or that I need to explain to you again, did you guys get a clear understanding of what was said? Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. And so now, we will call our ushers forward. I'm excited, amen. The last time we did this, the